What's up, guys? Today we are doing a Zoom quarantine, and I have all my boys with me. I can't physically introduce them, but you can see them on the screen. Soham, Bhavneet, and Hamad are here. And without wasting any time, we'll get right into it. India has seen, I don't know if this law still existed. I think it existed, but not this strictly. It's about vehicle scrappage. And basically, it means that after some point of years, a vehicle has to be sent to the scrapyard and you cannot use it anymore. What are your thoughts?
I don't know, man. I just feel like it's a good initiative because like you're actually reusing some metal and not digging up and mining out more metal from the ground, which is like economical as well as, you know, we're saving the environment from doing that. So I think so. It's a good initiative. But again, I think so. They should have some sort of concession for the people who want to like keep the classics and like cherish the classic cars that we have. A good example, Hamza, for you also is like you're looking at the City SX8, the 2000, like Type 1 and Type 2 cities. Those are cars that are still talked about till this day, 20 years after their launch in India, and those are some cars which people still buy because I feel they're good products in general and like they're very reliable and usable. So maybe some cars need like some concession here and there.
Bhavneet?
I agree with that, with most of what Soham said, apart from that some cars do actually need to go away. And classic cars are not a problem at all. Like your SX, say you go to a club and they will register it for you, no problem. And they're not going to like be pressuring you into scrapping it or anything at all. That's been happening already. And that's how people get away with getting those cars being scrapped from now. But I'm pretty sure now it's going to be much tougher to get that classic car registration. And the scrutiny will get a bit tougher for getting those cars registered again. And I mean, it's good. It'll encourage more people to go buy new cars, and something that India really needs. Hamad, what do you think?
So it's really funny. This is not India's first experiment with scrapping cars. In fact, Delhi, the rules are 10 years for diesel cars and you're supposed to scrap them. And for petrol cars, it's 15 years. But what's been happening in Delhi is they've just been selling these cars out of state, especially to UP and Haryana. So you see Delhi registered Scorpios there. So there's already sort of a loophole out of this. But I the reasoning for doing this is a little troubling because one of the reasons given is so people buy new cars. I am pretty sure in India, the reason for not buying, like people are not buying new cars, it's not because like they have their old cars. There are deeper problems which there are. But yeah, the good thing is like it encouraged people to scrap cars which are really bad for the environment, and then it'll be recycled. So that's the good thing about it. Otherwise, I feel like we'll have to wait and see what the eligibility for this is. And definitely they'll give out some compensation if they're scrapping your car. I mean, that's been made clear. So that's also good. Like it's a good initiative, but we still have to wait and see what the final what it's ironed out to in the end. Because a lot of times what happens in India is we look at laws and you're like, oh yeah, this will be done. And next thing you know, a bunch of cars are rotting away in one part of the city and it's taken up all the land there and it's another problem. Just like how what's happened in Delhi.
Right. Yeah, I agree to most of that. And the only loophole I see for classic car owners, which is any car which is 15 years or older can be registered with a club and they give you a fitness ticket stating it as vintage. So if you have a vintage car, you can take it out once in a while. So my SX8, which is going to be more of a daily, I don't know what I'm going to do around that. But that's that. Talking about unreasonable things, Tesla has been in the news quite a bit. I mean, let's put aside the memes and the jokes about his son's name. A tweet costed Elon a lot of money. And I don't know what the future holds. Soham, what are your thoughts?
I mean, what I've heard from is that, first of all, Tesla is not making profits at all. Like, they're like on the brink of just breaking even. The second thing is that Elon and his whole organization isn't following the COVID-19 laws, which have been put forward by the California government. He's one of, I don't know if he's a Republican or like he's a Trump supporter or whatever, but like, it's just stupid, man. Like, you're such a big, smart guy, and you make so many like insane rockets and everything, and you just can't like abide by a few laws and just like keep the world safe. Like, if you want to do something like that, he's thinking of changing the factory location out of USA, if I'm not wrong, but
out of California.
That's going to cost him quite a few, like the rebate and everything, the electrical rebate for EV vehicles. But yeah, what are your thoughts, Bhavneet?
Well, I don't know about Republican or Democrat, but he called the law of like the stopping of Tesla production as fascist. You know, it seems very Democrat, but I don't know. I think because he was just panicking because he's losing shit tons of money. He's losing money day by day right now. And as long as that factory doesn't open up, there's no good way out for him. And I'm pretty sure that's what's getting the best out of him. And yeah, I mean, Nevada, Texas are going to give him the same sort of rebate. I don't think $7,000, because those state governments are not that rich compared to California. But yeah, they will get a rebate even if they start producing anywhere away. And that's a big, big thing for them, because that's most probably why they're still afloat, because of those rebates. What do you think, Hamza?
Yeah.
Ahmad.
So the complicated part here is like, this comes out more of a hissy fit, because the production plant which Tesla is running in California used to be a Toyota plant. And during the 2008 financial crisis, Tesla bought it from them for just $50 million, but they've invested $42 billion into the plant. So the main question arises, where are you going to find another high-tech plant, and are you going to invest another $40 billion in it? So the government is actually not scared of him. It's a very awkward situation, because he's defying the orders very, very clearly. And I think Bhavneet is right. It's just because he's losing so much money, and Tesla was so close to breaking even. Something which most people are not aware of, Tesla has never made a profit. And this would have been the year they would have made a profit. But then coronavirus happened, and now it looks like it's going to go into the negative, because every day the factory workers don't come, you're losing money. And his tweets, like, I heard some rumors that people actually might throw him off the chairperson board in Tesla, because he's so erratic, and the shareholders are also losing their patience. So we'll have to see at this moment. Like, in the morning I read that the factory is open again, but all the workers are not going to turn up. I mean, that's pretty obvious. You don't want to lose your life working in a factory plant. Like, social distancing can't happen there, because people work side by side.
Yeah. So let's come back to home ground. And there was this bizarre news that happened earlier this week, that Honda is going to be selling two Honda Cities. Not one, but two. And from the looks of it, one of them is going to be... I want to put this off politely, but I can't find the words. The peasant version, or like the cheaper version, or the garib version of the car. And then they're going to have the nicer version of the car. I have read extensively about it, but like, I'll hand it off to you boys to let me know your thoughts first.
So if I'm not wrong, they're going to sell the current gen, which is sold in India, like the current shape, which is sold in India, as the taxi variant or something like that. And then they're going to get the newer generation in and like sell it as like a proper customer car. So like, people can, you know, choose the interior, the variants and everything. So I don't know what to say about it. All I can say is, like, the first of all, the new gen car that has come in, it's like a BMW Lexus ripoff. The lights are straight off a BMW. Like, you can clearly see it. But yeah, I mean, I just think they're trying to sell off the remaining stock of the older gen City or whatever. What about you, Bhavneet?
I'm just really excited that after lockdown, our Ubers and Olas are going to be mad on the backseat. They're going to be so nice. I'm sure they must have had some massive inventory left that they were like, yeah, okay, fine, give him at a substantially cheap amount. And yeah, they must be sending back it. How old is that City? Does anyone know how old is that body?
Five years.
Yeah. High time to change it. High time that they change it. So, I mean, I'm sure they must have screwed up and had so many cars of inventory here in India. So that's why they're just trying to dispose them off. What do you think, Amat?
It's a really, really strange thing because I read and, like, yeah, like as Soham was saying, the taxi car, like, that's an official plan. Like, this is not speculation. They're like at least aiming to offload around 80,000 cars to just fleets. So that shows that maybe they probably overproduce these cars a lot, and people are buying the Verna more, right? So, like, that's been a very big problem for them, and that's why these cars are left over. I'm very sure, like, they're still very good quality cars, so they won't have trouble finding buyers on them. But the only thing I read was, like, it'll only be 80K cheaper than the new City. So, like, I think customers won't pick up that car because it's just an 80,000 rupees difference.
You can get the new City.
Yeah. Yeah, and if you pay, because there'll be a world of difference in the technology and the car. So consumers, like customers who want to daily drive the car, I think they will spend that extra 80K. And I heard, like, they might slash the prices also overall. Like, the current City is, like, it starts at 9 lakhs. I think it might be starting at, like, 8 lakhs or something like that. They'll work it out. Like, they won't make a loss on it, but the profit margin is definitely going to reduce.
Definitely. I think the Honda City has been a favorite to most uncles in society, but Verna is doing better because they got the, you know, the seats which fold themselves and stuff like that. So it was all gimmicky, I'm guessing, but it's worked out for Hyundai. All right. So as Honda four-wheelers are digging their own grave, as I might call it, let's talk about Honda two-wheelers that have actually, like, been working in the right direction, I feel, this year. They launched the 2020 Activa. They put, like, the right suspension on it. They've done everything nicely. And now they're planning on localizing the 500cc unit engines with different body types. That is the Naked, which is a CB300. And we have the Rebel, which is a cruiser. And you have the Sport, the CBR 500R. What are your thoughts? So, you were excited about this particularly.
So Honda is, like, getting more premium motorcycles to India. So you did a video on the CBF 190R. I mean, like, taking that bike into consideration, they're getting, like, old stock to India, which is not great, but, like, at least we're getting something new. Because Honda, to be honest, has been really, like, hush-hush in that segment, like 300cc above. Very recently only they got the CB300R, and, like, the one we reviewed wasn't the best example of it, but I think you rode one and you were absolutely blown away by it. So, they got the CB300R to India, and I mean, it's a good bike, but I would say it is on the expensive side and doesn't really justify the price when you compare it to, like, the Austrian KTMs and everything like that. So, I mean, the biggest, the reason why I'm more excited about it is because of the localization that they're talking about, because they're saying that they're going to locally assemble and produce premium segment Honda bikes. What are your thoughts, Hamad?
I think this will be good, because the thing with Honda is, like, right now, even the 300cc bike, the CBR, it's a little expensive when it's compared to other bikes in the range. And it'll help them sell more numbers, which is what Honda actually needs right now. Because if you look, Honda's even like their numbers this year are literally made up of scooter sales, which is not a bad thing, like, which is what they aim to do. But I think this will give them a good boost in selling bikes at a more competitive price. And it's also good for India because that means more jobs.
Bhavneet, what about you?
I'm damn excited for the Rebel, man. That's my kind of bike.
Yeah,
I think it's gonna. It looks really ratty, and I really think it's gonna be nice and long.
Yeah, you know what I'm excited about? When those bikes hit the second-hand market, and they like depreciate a lot.
No, but I think so. I think so. When it comes to that, the Yamaha R3 has been in sale for India for quite a while, and if you look at the OLX, like the resale value of it on OLX, it hasn't gone down that much. Like, it's still 2.5, 2.75, 2.8. Yeah. I'll just cross.
Yeah, I'll agree with Soham because I have seen the price of these bikes. Owners are listing them for like 2.4. Like, I've seen barely any ads below 2 lakhs.
Yeah, yeah.
And the bikes are like 1,000 plus.
I have seen ads. I have seen an ad for 175. I've seen an ad for 215. I've seen an ad for 230 also. They are not selling about 250. I don't think.
No, I mean, they are.
I haven't stalked in a while. But like,
yeah, so 2018 good condition Yamaha R3 3 lakh 10, 2018 3 lakh 65, 3 lakh 25, and like, I'm talking about Pune right now, and like the cheapest one, like there are 4 on sale, and the cheapest one is for 2 lakh 50. So
how many kilometers?
The 2 lakh 50 one is for like 15,000, 3 lakh 25, 15,000, 3 lakh 65, 2,300, 3 lakh 10. Mm-hmm. 5,000. So, I mean, I don't know.
But that really puts into perspective what kind of people buy the R3. Like, they buy an R3 and they ride it for 3,000 kilometers. They're like, yeah, now I'm going to sell it. Why? But I think that's a different rant for a different day. Bro, but comparatively, I think the RC 390 on the second-hand market is dirt cheap.
It's dirt cheap, yeah.
Because I'm pretty sure that's because there's so many and it's just plastic. It's just plastic.
It's not even just long in plastic. It's just that so many people bought them. Like,
exactly.
Somebody was to quote those sort of prices, you'd just be like, I'll just buy it from this other guy. Like, I don't need to entertain this.
But the thing about KTM is actually, people think it's a really cheap brand, but it isn't actually. In like the States and Europe and everything, they're actually like up there with like Ducatis and like BMWs, and like in terms of pricing, I'm saying. So like, people in India think like, oh, they're so cheap and everything, but that's because Bajaj and like their whole...
We've got it easy out here.
Exactly.
Yeah, we really got it easy out here. That's the thing. Like, even if Honda starts producing the... If KTM was imported into the country, it would easily be double the price.
Easy.
But yeah, same thing with what is that bike called? I completely I forgot. But let's move on to the next topic. Le Mans, Porsche, and yeah, but the thing about the Husky is that I haven't ridden one, and I can't comment on it.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it's got the Duke 250 engine in it, you don't know for sure, like, because the chassis is everything, and the how you sit on a bike makes a world of difference. The Duke 250 is like a naked bike, but let's see what the once we get to ride the Husqvarna only, I think we can say something about it. I mean, Soham went and fanboyed over it. But yeah,
I like it, man. Like, it looks really good. Like, in terms of like design, I just think like a KTM is just too brash and like kiddie and everything with the colors and like the orange wheels. So like, getting the engines are really good. So that's why the Husqvarna really like speaks to me. But I think like the Svartpillen, which is like the scrambler kind of bike, it's basically a Duke 250 because of the handlebars and everything, but the Vitpillion is like more up my lane, and I think so that'll handle and like be a little bit different. But yeah, back to you, Hamza. What happened to him?
He left.
He left. It will wait for him now. I'll pause the record. Yeah, start it.
Yeah, so talking about all these cheap bikes, I also want to put something that actually flew under the radar, even though everybody made such a big hullabaloo about it. We're like, oh, this happened. TVS bought Norton. And this is like, we saw the marriage of Jaguar Land Rover with Tata. And now we're seeing Norton with TVS. I don't know what it is about British brands that, you know, Indians are like, you know what, you guys conquered us. Now we are conquering your brands. It's like, you know, we're coming back for you guys. Like something. I want to know your thoughts. Go on, so.
I forgot the price which they bought it at. What did they buy a Norton for?
153 crores.
How much?
153 crores.
Oh my God. That is like, it's dirt too cheap, man. But I think so it's given because that is like the correct price for which Norton. So I told you all the story and I'll tell everyone else. So basically Norton, like this is a UK story, not even an India story. So people in UK were like putting down deposits and giving money to like Norton dealerships and everything. And the thing was that Norton wasn't delivering bikes for like almost a year or some crazy number like that. So basically, what they used to do was that, for example, if Hamza has a Norton, some Norton Commander or whatever they sell, you give it for servicing, it's going to go to the service station for like at least 2 months, because that's how Norton works, regardless if anything is broken or not. And the reason behind that was because what they used to do in order to get new motorcycles out, when a customer owned like bike comes to the service center, they used to dismantle it and put the engine and some of the components which they do not have onto the new bikes and sell it as a new bike. So that was a really big scam which Norton was like found out and caught in, basically. And because of that, like, people went mad, man. So what are your thoughts about this, Bhavneet?
Well, see, when a big company, like a too big to fail company, tries to take over something that's already taken down and something that's not going to be doing well in the forthcoming future, it's usually really good news for the people trying to get out of that business. It's like, oh my God, yes, I'm getting out of this shithole. So, I mean, 153 crores is a big yes for Norton. And I can already see them making 125cc Nortons and selling them in India. But like, I mean, the reputation of Norton went to a level that couldn't be recovered. So, I mean, whatever happens now is good news for the name itself. But we don't know. I'm pretty sure for like 1 year, one and a half years, one good year of R&D can fix Norton. But let's see, that's up to TVS. What do you think, Ahmad?
I think, like, first of all, initially when it was reported in the media made it sound like, oh my God, it's a very big coup, you know, like, but I, when you look at it, like, I think the real winner here is TVS. TVS has been building solid products, but like, I think they're trying to emulate Bajaj over here, like what Bajaj did with the KTM, Husqvarna, and now even Triumph very soon. And Hamza's right, like it sounds very much like the earlier deal of Jaguar Land Rover and Tata. But I think the Tata Land Rover deal really teaches one thing, that even though Tata actually improved the cars, like Land Rovers became more reliable under Tata's stewardship, it almost sank Tata. Like, Tata had not made a loss until 2019 in the share market, and the Jaguar Land Rover sales had taken a negative hit on Tata. So, but yeah, like they managed to make a profit, which was crazy. It was the first time in 30 years that Land Rover was profitable, and that was under Tata. Drawing comparisons to the Norton deal, definitely, like as Bhavneet said, there'll be some localization, like 125cc Norton, like never say never. Like, it's India, anything can happen. But yeah, I think it's a good deal on both sides because, yeah, Norton's reputation, like, you just need to Google the name. And, like, the second or third thing which comes up is the story which Soham talks about, because it was that widespread. It was not like they did it with one or two customers. They did it to a fair number of customers. Hamza, what do you feel about this?
I don't know. I don't care about anything. I'm just excited to see the Norton N-Talk. That's what I want to see. Because I'm sure they're going to do something like that. There'll be a Norton N-Talk edition. Or what else? Jupiter N-Torque badging or something like that. Because it's TVS and they need to make money. Then we need to move numbers. Yeah. So speaking about moving numbers, I remember Porsche for some reason. And Porsche and what is the other company that has tapped out? Yeah, Corvette has tapped out of Le Mans. So I don't know how to feel about that because Porsche always brags about two things, the ring and Le Mans. Everybody wants to brag about going to Le Mans. And now that they are not going to Le Mans, I don't know what they're going to brag about. Like, Soham, what do you think?
So, I think more than, like, I don't think it's a big deal for Porsche because the thing with Porsche is that they have a lot of race teams that use Porsche cars in Le Mans. So, the particular team, which is actually the biggest, one of the biggest Porsche-centric teams for Le Mans is the IMSA racing team. So, they are the particular ones to drop out of Le Mans. So, it's not every Porsche team, but the big thing is, the factory Corvette team is not going to participate in Le Mans. And for 20 odd years, Corvette has been doing actually really good in Le Mans. And the C7R race car was a really like big hitter in the racing series. But the thing I think which is going to affect Chevrolet and Corvette is that they launched the C8 Corvette last year. And it got an amazing response because of the new technology and everything. But they have already stopped production of it for like the whole year to come. So like the next Corvette batch of C8 Corvettes is going to come in 2021. And now since they're not going to take part in Le Mans this year, this means that it is going to deter their brand image a little bit more because like the Z06 and like the crazy ones that come out of Corvette, they're really like based on like the race car which races at those series. So like I think it's just like a big bump in their career for like the Corvette racing team and everything. But yeah, what are your thoughts about it, Bhavneet?
Well, for Porsche, you could see it coming because WAG Group already had decided that all of their motorsports will. All of their internal combustion engine motorsport divisions will be shut gradually and in phases. And everything is going to become electric. That's where that IDR came out, that IDR project.
Shut up.
Why did Hamza just...
He doesn't like electric, no.
You should be happy, Bhavneet. You're the one who's always like, I'll swap my Polo.
My favorite company is stopping ICEs, bro. I love it. And they are going only electric. But yeah, Porsche, not surprised. They're going to do that everywhere. And Corvette, what I was pretty bummed out, it was because like it was the first time they got a mid-engine car with a really nice gearbox the stock gearbox can basically be like a little modded and put in the Le Mans car and it would be doing wonders. But because it's basically the same R8 gearbox, it's a ZF.
No. It's a DCT this time. It's an 8-speed DCT.
Doesn't it use the same one that they've got on the R8?
Yeah, no, like the manufacturers are the same.
The manufacturer is the same. ZF, right?
No, it's not ZF. It's something else. I'll check.
Okay, so they've actually got a very nice gearbox and mid-engine. And I mean, it would have done so much better in Le Mans. And it would have been like something just so I mean, radical within the company. I don't know why did they just like, they would have, they should have just done 1 year and like at least shown the true potential of the C8 Corvette.
I think this is like the Corvette's hype has been so crazy. Like, it's the only car people are talking about. And the thing which really helps it is the price point. I think it starts at $60,000. And for that money, that car is insane. Like, obviously, we've not seen any of these in India. Forget about like driving them. But whatever we've been able to see from the press, the car seems to be amazing. And like, this would have really helped the hype on the car if they at least got a good finishing in the Le Mans, because that's what really, really counts for a lot of enthusiasts, like how the car actually performs in these competitions.
Yeah, but I don't really care that Vettel left. Like, fuck him. Who cares?
No, like, I think it's a,
don't really
you
care.
Mean, it's a big deal.
Mean?
It's a big deal.
He's
in
been
the
like
world.
The... Like, he's been like one of the most disappointing drivers. And actually, I think it's not a big deal in the sense that it's natural. Like, this had to happen.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah,
like, he's underperformed. But at the same time, it is a big deal.
There's this mad series on Netflix called F1.
Yeah.
Mad.
Oh, man, that series has made F1 so popular. Like, I think women in India weren't too... Like, forget about being interested in cars. They didn't even, like most of them are unaware of the importance of F1. And because of this Netflix series, I've actually had a lot of women come up to me and say, like, oh, this is so interesting. Like, we actually watch this because it's so dramatic. And I think it's a really great series, the F1 series.
I'm going to start watching it today.
You have to. It's really good.
What F1, that series should shed light in on is how I don't know how to say it. How bitter our F1 drivers are, like for the first place. They literally, they're like chicks fighting for first place.
Other than that, I think, bro, also Soham, there are like 2 episodes on Vijay Mallya and Force India. 2 episodes.
In that
and
series.
Like, in the series, yeah. So,
yeah.
It's... At the end of the, like, after watching the entire thing, all you can understand is that if you have money, you're going to win podiums and nothing else. I think Ferrari is the only company which is like, you know what, we're broke this year, but we're still going to take a podium. I think Ferrari is the only team that does that.
So, there's a video on YouTube, I think so, I shared it with y'all. Or I think so, Bhavneet also must have seen it because I think I sent it to him. So it was like a distribution of the money in F1. So like Ferrari is like it gets a big chunk of the money. And it's very weird seeing like they get so much money for R&D and everything, but they still cannot come out on the top. And Mercedes is like dominating it. Like Lewis and Mercedes is just a different level right now. But yeah, I mean, I'll edit in like a clip of the whole money distribution of it, and it's crazy, man. And basically the way F1 functions nowadays, Williams and like all of the other small like the smaller team just cannot win because they just don't get that sort of budget. And when it comes to like sponsors and everything, like compared to the money that F1 actually gives you, and like sponsor money is just a whole different level. So, what about you, Bhavneet? Like,
well, F1's going to like die very soon. I'm sure there are like 2-3 seasons left of it, and then Formula E all the way. And I think Vettel also going to for another sport itself, because 2-3 seasons in a dying sport is not as good as 2-3 seasons in a budding sport. And I mean, Formula E is another ball game itself. Their fights, they're like fist fights, they're like zones and areas where you get boost. Most of it is city tracks, so everything is nice and narrow. Racing is all the time, and it's, you get fan boost, it's super interactive. So I mean, F1's screwed, to be completely honest. But Formula E is the way to go. And Formula One, it's it's still there because of the amount of money that is floating around it and the amount of people and the kind of people that are around it. But yeah, it's a dying sport. And even companies know that. What about you, Hamad?
Yeah, I would just like to add on to what Bhavneet said. Like when the VAG, like the WAG group pulled out of F1, all the major automotive respectable publications are like, okay, this is the beginning of the end. Because once Volkswagen steps out, slowly you'll see Nissan step out. Then if Nissan steps out, Renault steps out. And these are like the major engine providers for these competitions. And that's when the trouble actually starts. Like if Volkswagen, which is the biggest company, is saying, okay, this is not worth it. Like there has to be some reason behind it. And like you can see how F1, like I think last year, like there's a whole cultural shift also. Like I think last year the grid girls were removed from F1 because they were like, okay, this is actually outdated. And outdated things are slowly, slowly moving out. But it's not able to keep pace. Like what Bhavneet was saying, Formula E is so much more interesting to watch. Like it's so new. And it doesn't have any of the heritage which F1 has. And still people are tuning in. People are so much more interested. And yeah, the money plays such a huge important role in like how these things. Like if you look at, I'll give you a good comparison sport by sport. So let's just take England for that matter. The Premier League has a very similar thing. Like if you look at the money what Manchester United gets, or Manchester City gets, it's almost equal to the money which like a West Ham or someone gets. Like it's not that far off. But if you go to Spain, which is an actual, like you can look at it side by side to what the F1 teams do. Teams like West Ham get more money than big clubs like Atletico Madrid when it comes to TV rights. And that's exactly what's happening in F1. Williams, which was a team with so much history, they barely get one by fifth of what Ferrari is getting. So how on earth are they supposed to compete with them? So in that sense, yeah, it's getting outdated and like it's dying. And I think like, but I disagree with Bhavneet that it has 3 seasons left. I think it has a little more.
Oh,
than that.
But like I was just being
adding on to what Hamad is saying, and I think so. It's going to like F1. Like I don't know how long it's going to stay around for. But the thing is like F, even like the internal combustion engine is dying, and like F1 has always been around, like the IC and everything. Do they have hybrids? I'm not very up to date on F1. Are the current cars hybrid or something? No.
Not at all.
They have a curse system, yeah. So it's kind of a hybrid, but like
electronically assisted.
Yeah, engine. Yeah. But I mean, it's always been around like the engine. So you had like the V12 era, the V10 era, and like now it's getting down smaller and smaller and smaller, the engine capacities. And like when it comes to the aero and stuff, yeah, of course, like the aero is going to go forward. But I think so that aero is going to be shifted into Formula E, and more brands are participating in Formula E than F1. And if you look at F1, like most of the brands which are participating, like the smaller ones, Williams and all, they don't actually produce cars. So when it comes to Formula E, Jaguar, Porsche, Audi, and all of the big brands actually participate in them. And when you participate in a good racing series and you get good podium finishes and like good scores in that, it boosts your sales and it shows off in like the charts and everything. So I think so. Formula E has to be the way forward. What about you, Hamza?
I don't know, man. I'm just really sad. Because I really like the internal combustion engine. I like my spinny boys. I like exhaust notes. Like I can't even get myself to like the Takan. Fuck that car.
That car is crazy.
It's crazy. It's crazy.
So I get it, but that's a rant for a different day. I think we'll close for today. Thanks for joining, boys. And if you're new here, subscribe to us. We yap about shit like this all the time. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.